I am pairing tonight's teardown with Half Pints Brewing's Stir Stick Stout. They describe it as having notes of dark roast coffee and semi-sweet chocolate offset with classically bright Golding's hops. A medium-bodied coffee stout considered as a nightcap or the best part of waking up. Today I am doing a teardown of this old audio amplifier. This particular one is branded Reamer 800-35 solid state amplifier. It is a 35 watt audio amplifier made by the True Tone Electronics Inc. of North Hollywood, California. This one is from the mid 70s and spent most of its life at the church that my grandfather used to go to back when he was alive. As a matter of fact, that donation sticker there had his name on it, along with a few other World War I veterans. But this thing was taken out of service a few years ago, and my parents decided that I really should have it for reasons. Because I'm into things with wires, I guess. So for controls on the front, we have two microphone inputs, one switchable micro auxiliary level input, a music input with two switchable inputs, and then a bass and a treble, power, and an LED. Not too much going on in the front. This is the kind of thing that you would find in, like, for used for background music or paging in an office or a factory or something like that. And I'm guessing it was just an affordable one for the church to buy back, you know, in the 70s. On the back side here, we have power cord coming in and then the switched power going back out. Little resettable circuit breaker. We have some screw terminals for speaker outputs, 4 and 8 ohms, and also it can drive 70 volt or 25 volt distributed speaker systems. Those are very common with, like, in-ceiling speakers in offices and whatnot, and places that you have long runs of speaker cable going to multiple small speakers. I'll put a link down in the description to a Wikipedia article on these 70 volt speaker systems or higher voltage speaker systems. So the other inputs over here, we have three microphones, switchable low and high impedance. Now back when solid state amplifiers first came out after tube amplifiers, most of the microphones that were common at the time would have been high impedance microphones, because that is the sort of preferred input impedance for tube-based amplifier circuits. Unless, of course, you put an impedance matching transformer on or something. Anyway, so that's why that was common. These days, dynamic microphones are almost entirely low impedance, except for some very specialty stuff. But these ones, you could switch either one. And then we have the just some RCA jacks, the auxiliary input, and two music inputs. Those are, you know, line level on an RCA, minus 10-ish dBm, thereabouts. And then there's this pair of screws up here, mic precedence. That basically mutes the music when you close that circuit. So if you've got a microphone with a push-to-talk switch on it, that push-to-talk switch would short that, causing the music to drop out so that the microphone could be heard better, which, in the application this thing was used in, is pointless, but in, like, an office or a paging application, it makes perfect sense. Then there's this interlock or external amp. That basically allows, if you have multiples of these things, you can patch them together with that, and that puts the mix bus inside into parallel so that all the amplifiers that are paralleled that way have access to all the inputs and all the speaker outputs. So if you had two or three of these things stacked, you get a bunch of different microphones that could all get onto that bus and out to all the other amplifiers, and then you could have multiple 35 watt outputs going to multiple different places. It's, again, not something that you see commonly these days, but it was relatively common back then. So there's just a few screws holding it together, so I'll hoik those out and pop the lid and come back momentarily here. Okay, here we go. No circuit board. It's all turret board, point-to-point kind of stuff. That is interesting back there. We have three transformers. I'm going to assume that that is the output transformer. That one is pretty clearly the power transformer, in as much as it's, you know, primary wiring is connected to the power cables over there. I'm not entirely sure what this guy is. Oh, so that is an output transformer. Okay. I stand corrected from before. So that is going to all of the speaker screw terminals down there. All right. So what is this one doing then? It looks like this one is connected to that board there and that little board there. Oh, that's interesting. That is a little metal clip that's over top of a transistor. So that will probably be the final drive output transistor, I'm guessing. Meanwhile, over here, we have the three microphone input jacks and some resistors in there to the switches. So that might be the impedance switching. And then those cables all come over to the boards. They said a LAN between these three boards. Okay. And this one kind of lands between these boards here. All right. So we got a couple of transistors there, a couple there, another one there. Looks like that one is not an original. There's the small audio electrolytic capacitors, these silver guys here. And that one looks like it's been replaced at some point in this thing's lifespan. Anyway, this is very classic of the era. This is pretty much exactly what I was expecting to find in here. So maybe we can follow this through a little bit from the start. So there is the circuit breaker. There's the power coming in. This power transformer. Here is a wire going to the power switch on the front and then back. There is the full bridge rectifier. Insert electro boom sound effects here. There is the main power supply filtering capacitor, which is a 3000 microfarad 50 volt capacitor. This resistor over here is going to the LED on the front panel. It is a red LED, of course, because that's all that existed at the time. I'm actually surprised that it has an LED for, you know, early to mid 70s. That's kind of modern and cool of them, actually. So unlike a lot of equipment these days, there is only one voltage in this power supply, and that's the one being generated by this. And there is its wires going over to the circuit boards. So back here, there and there, got a couple of 0.005 microfarad, I'm assuming, capacitors. And it is. That's the final drive transistors. There's a pair of them. Okay. So this guy down here isn't the final drive. It's probably, yeah, okay. So that one is driving this transformer, which has its two secondaries, I'm guessing, going to these two power transistors. So with these two power transistors and this transformer on the, I guess, base side of it, this isn't going to be MOSFETs. This is going to be BJTs. I'm almost certain of it. Back at this point in history, MOSFETs were horrendously expensive and notoriously fragile. So I don't think they would have been used in this kind of an application at that point. So the secondary output from this transformer, it'll be center tapped, and it'll be feeding the bases of these two transistors. Then the outputs of these transistors, probably the collector, I'm guessing, will go to the primary of this transformer here. Yep. That's this red wire here and this blue wire here. Going to the primary of this transformer. That'll be the output transformer, which drives the speaker outputs. Okay. These are extremely simple circuits going on. This is standard old school stuff, but it's just fun to see. Shall we connect it up and see if it works? So I've got my 30 watt 8 ohm speaker here, which I will connect to the 8 ohm output. Oh yeah, you can actually see what they were using too. The only two screws that are unscrewed are the common and 70 volts. So that's what they were using at the old church. But I am going to use the 0 and 8 ohms for my speaker. So let's see what happens here. Power there. Where's the power switch? There it is. We have hum. A little bit of hum. Okie dokie. Let's just see what's going on in here. 200 volt setting on that one. I'm just going to measure across the power supply capacitor because that will be the power that the thing is seeing. 42 volts. Okay. Is there any AC ripple on that? Or how much AC ripple is there on that is probably the better question to ask. Okay then, 90 volts, wow. Given that, I'm surprised it's not humming as much as any more than it is. Let's plug into the auxiliary input. That works. Turn that down a little bit. That sounds surprisingly good. I wasn't expecting that, especially with that power supply ripple. Wonder if I got a microphone. Well, I've got a microphone around here, but do I have a dynamic microphone? Because this thing won't do a condenser microphone, at least not directly. Let me go digging around. No, I don't. But what I do have is a speaker, which is mechanically the same. Don't create a short circuit. What was it? Oh, yeah. Speaker is electrically the same thing as a dynamic microphone. So I'll plug it in there. I'm switched to low impedance. I'll turn that up. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Wow, that actually sounds pretty good. And of course, if I point them at each other. Sorry about that. Yes, it will feed back. So there's nothing wrong with this. It's just old and a bit hummy. Well, that's kind of cool. I don't know what I'm going to use it for. Maybe I'll use it for blasting music in the backyard. Nah. Let me see what I can find out about this old guy on the internets. True Tone Electronics Inc., a California company who filed their incorporation, I guess that means, in May of 1953. Wow. But they are dissolved and no longer exist, so we can't get any more information on the products that they're making right now, because they're not. According to the Radio Museum, here's some of the kind of things that they were making way back then. Tube amplifiers, broadcast receivers. This one they're thinking is sort of mid-70s as well, so that's... Actually, yeah, the logos look pretty similar, don't they? And there's a hi-fi amplifier that they made. Oh, what's the back of that look like? Tubes again. Okay. So the Radio Museum is guessing that this is around 1955. Okay, so this is the kind of stuff that this company made. Somebody's actually trying to sell one on eBay right now for $37 plus shipping. And yeah, that looks like the sort of an application that you would expect. That looks like it was a hospital paging system. Microphone 1 coming from the switchboard, microphone 2 coming from the emergency room. And I found the manual! This is awesome! So I'll put a link to this down below, actually, so I don't have to read it all out to you, because that makes a very boring kind of a video, I think. But here it's talking about that mic precedence, or they call it mic mute in this manual, and basically, just when the dispatcher pushes the push-to-talk button, it shorts that and it mutes the music. This is an application that I've never run into before for the high voltage speakers. They say you can put multiple units with the speaker wiring in series of the amplifiers, and then run it out to the speakers to get higher wattage. So if you put three of these 35 watt amps in series on the 25 volt taps of the transformer, you can get 105 watts at 70 volts. Oh, hey, and a schematic. Look at that. So there's the power supply, single DC voltage going up into the circuit. It goes into a center tap of that output transformer and then feeds the collectors of those two driver transistors. So the base of those two output transistors gets its feed from the smaller transformer, which is the one that's hanging on the back panel there. And it's driven by this one. So you can see here, this is, again, that positive voltage rail center tapped onto there. And then the base of these two comes off the secondaries out of phase. So when the top one is being driven positive and that transistor turned on, the lower one is being, its base is being driven negative and it is shut off. And then as the sine wave or AC waveform changes, then this one is going negative and turned off, and this one is going positive and turned on. So this transistor that's driving that transformer will be the one that had the little metal clip on it acting as a heat sink. And then here we have the preamp sections. There's your tone controls in between this preamp stage and this one over here. And this one is the preamp in out. That's the link that I was talking about to the other amplifiers potentially. Comes in there on the base of this preamp stage there. Over here we have mic 1 preamp and its impedance switch. Mic 2 preamp and its impedance switch. And all the audio signals go through their volume control, through the potentiometer, onto the mix bus. And then that all goes to the base of this preamp transistor. So here is mic 1 and its volume control going on there. Mic 2 and its volume control. Mic 3 or the auxiliary and its volume control all going onto that bus. Here's the auxiliary coming in through this series resistor straight in from the RCA jack. So that tells us that the mix bus is going to be close to that line level, that neg 10 to 15 dBm-ish that you normally get on an RCA line level audio jack. Okay, and then we scroll down here, and here's the music, again, going on through its pot. There's that mute. We'll take a look at that in a second. Here's the two music inputs with the switch between them. Here's the music mute. One side of it's ground, and one side of it goes through this 470K resistor and to this capacitor to bring that music line low. Basically, when it's in normal operating mode, this capacitor's got a positive charge on it. That is coming from the power supply. If we follow that all the way up, it comes from that same power supply line. And then when you short the mute here, it discharges that capacitor through here and brings it down to ground, which essentially doesn't quite short it, but brings it, you know, within 470K of ground. Nice and simple. And very much what I was expecting from just poking around inside the circuit. So I forgot to demonstrate that mic precedence thing there. So we've got some music coming in through one of the music inputs. If I do this, it mutes it. Lets me make my announcement through the speaker there. And then it comes back on as soon as I remove that. And it doesn't affect the microphone, what it's doing, but it just makes it a lot easier to hear. Anyways, I'm going to finish my beer and put this guy back together and maybe wallow a bit more in nostalgia, but that was a lot of fun. I like, hearkening back to a simpler time, really. And there's not much to go wrong in there. It's pretty obvious how to work on it if you're even the least bit familiar with basic BJT circuitry. It's all NPN transistors. There's nothing too complex in there, really. I hope you enjoyed that. I found it informative and, like I said, a bit of a nostalgia trip back to some of the kind of stuff that I used to work on early in my career. Questions or comments, memories down below as usual. I'll talk to you later.